Are you ready? Sea of Red, it's time for another episode of Fireside Chat.
Another week of Flames hockey, and for the second time this season, the Flames won two in a row, and that also means they swept this week. As we talk this week, it looks like the Flames' fortunes might be turning around, and here to celebrate that is myself, as always, and Matt. How you doing, buddy?
Good. Nice to see the Flames sweep a week for a change.
Yeah, if you look at the week before, they lost 3 of 4, and they swept and got their second two wins in a row, and both of them came this month, both at home, too, which is kind of interesting. The last one was earlier in the month. On the 5th, they beat the Philadelphia Flyers, and on the 7th, they beat the Pittsburgh Penguins. Overall thoughts on this week, Matt?
A lot more composed play, and especially with two very different styles of teams. New Jersey being more of a counterpunch team and Chicago more of a in-your-face offensive team. I thought the Flames did a very good job of countering each of the other team's strengths and just allowing the offense to come as it did.
Well, let's talk about each game. On Tuesday the 17th, the Calgary Flames ended up playing here at home against the New Jersey Devils. They ended up winning 3-2, and that was a regulation win, no overtime needed. And I think one of the stories of the game on that one might be the continued dominance of David Jones. I never expected David Jones to come out this year and look like a star. We've been critical of him in the past, and we're seeing him night in and night out be the best player on the ice.
Yeah, he's been surprising. That's for sure. Like, he's rocketed all the way up into the team lead in goals, which, being the latter half of November, I don't think anybody would have ever thought that that would be the case.
And, you know, I mean, do you think, Matt, it's just a case of him being in a contract year, or do you think it's just a matter of, I don't know, David Jones getting a spark all of a sudden? What do you think's causing this?
I think it's just a bit of everything. I think he saw that Curtis Glencross, who should have received a 2 or 3 year contract in the $2.5 to $3 million range, not be able to find any work. And another guy like Lee Stempniak, who's also a decent second, third line guy like Jones, he had to sign for only $800,000 with New Jersey. And he sees the writing on the wall that if he doesn't have a really good season, nobody's going to sign him. And the fear of not having a contract beyond this year is probably one of the main factors for him to be in the best shape he's been as a Flame. And he's been playing like he really wants another long-term contract.
Yeah, and, you know, it is a contract year for Jones. He's making $4 million this year. I think we all said at the beginning of the year, let Jones walk. But I think based on his play right now, if you look at his numbers so far, he's putting up impressive numbers. And last year, he played 67 games and got 14 goals. This year, he's played 21 games and has 7 goals. So he's halfway to his high number for last year, 14, and not even played half the games yet. So I think if I was the Flames at this point, I would talk to Jones about another deal next year, but I don't think I would, even if he continues this pace, I don't think he's worth anywhere near $4 million. What do you think?
No, and realistically, if you're going to re-sign Jones, I think it's going to be more in the 2.5 to 3 range, and even then, it would be more depending on who's in the organization and like if anybody else is coming up and trying to push for spots as well.
Do you think the Flames could afford a 3-year David Jones contract long term? I'm thinking if you did that, it would almost have to be a 1 or 2 year deal just to kind of say, okay, you did good. Show us now you can do it for us again, and then we can talk long term. And I mean, he's getting older too.
Yeah, I don't think I'd go 3 years just because you've seen how the Mason Raymond contract has pretty much bit the team in the butt. A 1 year or 2 year deal, say at like $6 million for the 2 years, I think that would be sufficient. I don't see too many teams wanting to line up and offer him a 3 or 4 or 5 year deal.
He's 31, so he's sort of in that mid-range as far as age goes. But yeah, no, I wouldn't. I probably wouldn't do 3. I could see doing 1 or 2, and I think 3 would be lucky if he could get that. I'd probably be throwing him a number, and of course you're going to go higher or lower. But if I'm Treliving, I'd probably throw him an offer at about, I don't know, 2.5, and maybe go up from there if I need to.
Yeah, and realistically, the team can replace a guy like Jones through the free agent market. You'd always like to keep your own players, though, because at least you know roughly what you have, where if you bring somebody in, they might just not fit with anybody, and then you're stuck.
Yeah, no, that's very true. While we're talking about the New Jersey game, the goals in that game for the Flames, we saw Brody get his second of the year, Matt Stajan get his first of the year, and it's always good when a veteran's getting his first, and David Jones, of course, scores 7th of the year. I thought in that game, if you look at, you know, guys like Stajan scoring, I thought that the third line was probably the hardest working line on the ice that night.
As they have been since they've been put together, the Colborne, Stajan, Jones line has been really fantastic. Their chemistry seems to be working on full cylinders lately, and it's taken a lot of pressure off of the Gaudreau line and the Bennett line.
And I think it's cool that we finally found a home, I guess would be the best way to say it, for Stajan and Jones, two guys that just seemed in the past to sort of drift up and down the lineup. We found a home for those guys that seems to be working and seems to be really clicking for them.
Oh, for sure. And you never like to see players struggle needlessly. And having those two guys fit with either a guy like Ferland or a guy like Colborne, it helps just to take the pressure off of everybody else.
For sure. And that New Jersey game was probably more, I guess, I wouldn't say critical, but had a little bit more weight to it than we would expect from an Eastern Conference game, because we have a couple former Flames there. We have Camilleri there, and we have Stempniak there, and both of them were back here playing against the Flames. Neither one made it onto the score sheet. Oh, I guess Stempniak and Camilleri both got an assist. That's right. They got an assist on the 2-2 goal. I'm surprised 2-2's still around, too.
Yeah. Yeah. I was actually shocked that 2-2 was out on the power play.
Yeah, that's
one,
an odd choice.
It worked, so, you know, you can't really fault the coach on that one.
No. And, of course, Cariramo picked up the win in that game. And then the next game that the Flames played was against the Blackhawks. And this was the game I was really worried about based on the previous Flames game that we played against the Blackhawks in the United Center earlier in the week, where we got down 4-1. I was interested to see if the Flames could fire back, but honestly not too confident that they would. And this game, the Flames ended up winning 2-1 in OT. We had goals from Monahan and a goal from Goudreau in the OT. You were at the Dome for this one. From what I could hear watching or listening to this one on the radio and watching this on TV, it sounded electric in there. Can you tell us about the atmosphere in the Dome for the Chicago game?
It was mostly hesitant through the first two periods. I think everybody was just waiting for the wheels to fall off. But especially in the third period and overtime, it really started to pick up, and heard the first Go Flames Go chant, it seems, and like a month, and like the fans really started to support the team as the clock ticked down.
That's good.
And it, you know, the lack of fan support hasn't really been a surprise, especially with how the team played in the first month. But now that the team seems to be coming around and might actually be able to push for a playoff spot, they're coming around as well.
In this game against the Hawks, you could tell that the Flames weren't happy with their last outing against Chicago. You could see right from the beginning that they made some changes, they made some adjustments to how they wanted to play their game, and I think even in the first period, I don't know about you, but in the first period, I could even tell that the Flames were setting the pace for how the rest of the game was going to go.
Yeah, and one of the major adjustments, the Flames against the Hawks last week, they keyed in on Taves because they didn't want him to beat the team. And they were putting like the best defenseman out somewhat repeatedly against the Taves line. And it turned out that it was actually the Anisimov, Panarin, and Kane line that was doing all the damage. And by the time they made the adjustments, it was too late in that one. But on Friday, the Flames, they keyed in right from the get-go on shutting down Kane's line. And even though he did get a point on the power play, they didn't really generate a lot of offense throughout the contest.
No, and even looking at the shots, it was 19 shots for the Blackhawks and 37 for the Flames, who were having a lot more offense.
Which, I can't remember the last time the Flames outshot Chicago, period, let alone by that kind of a margin.
Yeah, that's more than double. Almost triple.
Yeah.
And, you know, I think you're right about, you know, us changing the matchups, and I think having the home team changing advantage helped too. Last change at home, definitely you could see helped with that because they knew who was on the ice for Chicago. Would you say, I don't know about you, I would say this was the best 60 minutes of hockey we've seen for the Flames. What do you think?
Yeah, I can agree with that. That and the Penguins game were the two best performances by the Flames all season. With Chris Russell getting hurt in the first period, I thought that both Dougie Hamilton and Dennis Wideman both stepped up their game to absorb the extra minutes quite effectively. And I think if it wasn't for those two players specifically taking a step further, they wouldn't have collected the 2 points.
Yeah, and you know, I think that's one of the things that we saw last year the Flames did so well, is when somebody was out, the team stepped up to fill that guy's spot, whoever it was. And I thought, you're right, we saw that well in the Chicago game of, you know, other guys stepped up and filled that spot. And it was, for a team like the Flames to go against a team like Chicago and only have 5 defensemen on the bench after the first period, that's pretty scary. But the Flames were able to fit to, you know, work with the matchup issues they were having with Chicago, just, you know, the difference in roster, and still be down a defenseman and come out on top. And I think that's really a testament to everybody on the team.
Yeah, and if they can continue to build off of, like, we can actually win games against the best teams, that should be able to propel them forward, so that way, like, they don't fall into the same bad mistakes that they were making in the early part of the season.
And I think if you look at the Flames' wins, I mean, the two biggest wins they've had so far were against, I'd say, the Blackhawks this game and earlier this month against the Penguins. So we're beating the good teams. And I think maybe that's what's going to really help turn around the confidence with this group.
Oh, for sure. And in the last 10 games, the Flames have actually won 6 out of them. So as a whole, the team is starting to sort itself out. It's just, it's got to continue to build on these successes. And especially with this week upcoming, facing the Ducks in Anaheim and the Dallas Stars, they have to make sure that they're at the top of their game.
Interesting note that the Flames are now 5-0 this season in games that have ended in 3-on-3. So they're the team that I guess we're doing well with less guys in the ice. Maybe we can pull 2 players and play 3 guys all game and win more of them.
Yeah, I don't know about that, but the Flames definitely seem to have the advantage because of the fact they can throw out 2 defensemen that are quality defenders, but can also be very dangerous up front as well. And having the ability to throw that kind of a format out on consecutive shifts really starts to wear down the opposition.
Yeah, and you can have multiple groups of those guys. Like, you could throw maybe 2 different defensive pairs out there and a couple different forwards with them. And I think you're right, we're very versatile in what we have available to us to play in the in the 3-on-3.
Yeah, because like the first lineup, you could have Monahan with two defensemen, then Gaudreau with two defensemen, and then the third group could be, say, Bennett and Hudler with another defenseman.
And most of the time, you just rotate through between two lines.
Yeah. Well, sometimes there is a third line out there, so like you could, like if you have to throw out your third grouping, you could do two forwards. But
speaking of Hudler, Yari Hudler sat out that game in Chicago. He had a mild flu, and that was a last minute decision. And when I saw on TV that we had Mason Raymond playing on the first line, I was nervous.
Yeah, he played rather well for Raymond, and like there was a couple mistakes that he made in the game, but he was actually quite effective. I thought he played his best game of the season.
Not only his best game of the season, I would argue his best game as a Flame.
Well, I'd say second best. That hat trick against the Oilers at the beginning of last season was probably his best game, but other than that, yeah, I would agree with you there.
Do you think this is a case of Mason Raymond maybe finally seeing the light like Jones is, that, hey, I got to come around and play better? Or do you think this is one of those cases that we could put almost anybody on a line with Monahan and Gaudreau and they'd look better?
I think it's a little bit of A and it's a little bit of B, because I think Raymond is seeing the fact that like all the other lines on the team are clicking. And if he doesn't start to show something, that he's going to be Stockton bound soon. So
yeah, or at least up in the press box eating some popcorn.
Or in the press box. Yeah.
Yeah, and I think if you look around at the roster, he's really one of the few guys that doesn't have a home. I mean, you know, we have, and I think one of the keys to the Flames' success right now is Hartley's finally stopped tinkering with the lines.
True.
And he's got his set, you know, 1, 2, 3, and 4. And Raymond doesn't really have a home. So I think this was his chance. And sort of, you could tell that he really didn't have a home because Hartley doesn't even want to disturb the other lines. I mean, realistically, you'd probably give a guy like David Jones, who's played very well, the chance in the first line, but he doesn't want to disturb Jones's third line. So you put the guy coming back in, which is Mason Raymond, drawing back in the lineup on the first line. And I thought it was a good showing for Raymond, and hopefully that can kickstart him to keep playing the same way. It's like, look, you've got it in you. You've shown that. Keep doing it. But if he can keep playing like that, I'd keep putting Mason Raymond in the lineup.
Well, Yuri Hudler is still expected to be a game-time decision tomorrow, and Raymond may draw into his second consecutive contest on that first line.
And in fact, in practice today, they had Raymond practicing with Gaudreau and Monahan, and Hudler was the odd man out of practice.
Yeah, so we'll see. If he plays well again, then that begins to open up a different story entirely, but we'll just have to wait and see following the Ducks game how the whole team plays and go from there.
Yeah, it's easy to have one game of success, but you're right. I think it's going to be two or three that he needs to string together in a row to kind of say, hey, I can do this. You know, look at the body of work I have now as part of this first line.
Yeah, plus it would not be a bad thing to have Hudler sit out a game, because he's been struggling mightily for pretty much the last 2 weeks anyway.
Yeah, it's just, I don't know, wrapping my head around a first line, including Mason Raymond, it's still weird to me.
Yeah, but stranger things have happened, so we'll see.
When I look at the key to success over the last little bit, I think we also have to credit Kari Ramo. I would say that he's really had a resurrection. I mean, if you look at the way the goaltending's worked out this season, we started with three guys. He really started, I'd say, as the backup. He got relegated to Stockton, called back up because of an injury, and now he's played, what, 10 in a row? And he's really looking like the goaltender the Flames need if they're going to put something together this season.
Oh, for sure. And he's finally bumped his save percentage over the 900 mark, which, after how the season started, that's good progress. And
he doesn't look like a guy who should have been relegated to the
No. He's looking like how he played last year. And the interesting thing that I'm looking forward to see this week is how Jonas Hiller plays, and if he can start to rekindle himself.
Yeah, and it'll be interesting to see, because the Flames play three games this week, two of which are back-to-back. You're probably not going to see them start Ramo again in both back-to-backs. But, you know, we've talked a lot in the past about Ramo and how he seems to do better under competition. And I wonder if maybe he's looking around saying, this is my time to seize the starting role.
Yeah. And
Hiller's out. The team has no confidence in Ordeo. So this is my time to establish that. So when Hiller does come back, he's backing me up.
Yeah, exactly. And until Hiller can prove that he's playing at a similar or better level, the net is still Ramos for the foreseeable future.
And I think it's interesting that even with Hiller out, the team really, I don't think they've played Ordeo once, even this month.
Not since Ramo took the net back. That was it for Ordeo.
Yeah, so, you know, even to be the backup, but the Flames not to even play you, you know, like usually you get out there kind of once a month, once every 10 games, that sort of thing. But you can really tell where the team's faith lies.
True. And I think now that Hiller, like, once he is able to play as the backup, Ordeo will be the backup in Anaheim. Once Hiller's back fully, I think you will see Yanni Ordeo being sent to Stockton.
Yeah. Yeah, well, and there's some issues we'll talk about later, but I guess why don't we talk about them now? Yeah, it makes sense. I mean, we just got Kevin Poulin brought in, and already he's hurt.
Yeah, and it was a really weird play. Like, it was in the shootout in the last game for Stockton, and he went to make the kick save, and he missed. And while he was in that position, his supporting leg, not the leg that he kicked out, buckled under him and completely screwed up, and he was not able to put any weight on it. And when he did attempt to, his knee buckled again. And apparently when he was with the New York Islanders, his knee was an issue, and it might be a longer term thing, not like a 2-week injury. I think he might be out for months.
Well, if you look back at his career, he's had a history of knee injuries. In 2010-2011, his season ended early due to a knee injury, which actually required a season-ending surgery, and he suffered the same injury back in juniors. So this is something that he's struggled with for quite a while now. And something that when you bring a guy in like that, you know what you're getting. You know that, you know, there's a history there. So, you know, the Flames brought him in to be the backup, unfortunately, at the AHL level, unfortunately, with Gillies out and now him out. Kent Simpson had to step off the bench to finish the shootout, and the Heat won. But if you look at the Flames now with Kent Simpson and Eric Hartzell playing as their 1-2 in the AHL, that's not a tandem I'd be confident with.
No, and I think that's why you'll see Ordeo be assigned to Stockton soon, just because of the fact that you can't rely on that level of goaltending and expect the team to be able to win consistently.
Yeah. Yeah, either they're going to have to put Ordeo down in Stockton, or they're going to have to find a free agent goalie or somebody they can get for cheap from somebody else, because especially if you're trying to have Stockton be competitive.
Make the Poulin trade again, basically.
Yeah, make the Poulin trade, or, you know, make another trade and wrap a goalie into it, or find a Joey McDonald type who is sitting on unrestricted free agency and say, hey, will you come in and work for us for the year?
Yeah.
But I just...
Maybe we should contact Minnesota and get Leland Irving back.
We could. What about Kevin Lalonde or any of those guys that were in the organization at the time?
Yeah.
Heck, what's Freddie Brathwaite doing these days?
Who knows?
You know, like there's a lot of options out there for goalies that have some NHL experience. And I was one of the guys, if you remember at the beginning of the year, I suggested that we might want a guy with some experience down in the AHL anyways. Poulin filled that. But if you think about it, Matt, everything that could go wrong for Calgary with their goalies this year has gone wrong.
Pretty much. Yeah, I don't think there's anything that's gone by the books.
No, you know, we couldn't make a decision up here. We had to carry three goalies in Calgary.
Gillies gets that concussion, and then the hip injury. Gillies gets a concussion. Yeah, it's just been a mess.
I mean, I guess the only good thing is that Gillies turned pro this year. Maybe that's the only good thing we can say about goaltending.
Yeah.
Ordeo is supposed to be the goalie of the future. Seems to have lost the confidence of the organization. So it's been a weird year for goaltending.
Yeah.
I wonder if there's going to be another year where, maybe not at the NHL level, but do you remember that year the Flames went through like 10 goalies? Maybe we're going to see that in the AHL this year.
Yeah. That was an interesting period in Flames history.
They should call Brent Cron.
Yeah. He's around.
Tyler Moss.
Come on down.
Yeah, exactly. You've played for the Flames in the past. You wore pads. You still got your red pads and your red mask. Come on out and play.
Yep. As long as you can stand up, you're good to go.
I mean, we're not going to turn McDonald pro because of this, but they have to find something, and I don't want them to give up a big asset to get another AHL goalie. So,
oh, no.
You know, there's got to be some. I'd have to look at the list of who's still a UFA, but there's got to be somebody in Europe or, you know, playing in the ECHL or something like that that we can call in. Do you know if there's any goalies with a name that are still out there?
Honestly, I don't. I think maybe a guy like Ray Emery might be available, but
would he be able to find his way to the rink?
I have no idea. So
yeah, I don't know. I'd have to take a look.
It's an interesting problem that's not really a huge problem, but something that will have to be addressed in the next couple of weeks for the Flames.
Well, then the interesting thing, too, if we sign somebody, is what do we do when Gillies is healthy again?
Exactly.
And Poulin's healthy again.
Yeah. Exactly.
I guess it means Colorado's going to get a good goalie.
Pretty much.
But I really hope that this is not... I mean, Poulin's only on a one-year deal, so if he's injured for the rest of the year, it's not like we have a huge salary hit there. But just for his sake, I hope that he can bounce back and play some more games this year. I hope this isn't a career or a season-ending injury like it was in 2010-2011 for him.
Oh, for sure. And it's really disappointing because in the games that he did play for Stockton, he actually played rather well. And he collected a shutout in the first game this week, and he played really well in the second one, only to have a stupid injury in the shootout.
Yeah, and that's, you know, that's got to suck for him too, because he's trying to make a name for this team and earn a starting role, and then down he goes. And when you have a nagging injury,
I know, he's especially because he's trying to return to the NHL and like try to become a backup or something at the NHL level, and then to have a rather lame injury, it just, you know, it must be frustrating for him.
Well, at least we only gave up future considerations.
Yeah, which I would assume that is basically nothing now.
Yeah. Yeah, I think anything we were going to give up was like, hey, you gave us a broken goalie. But yeah, no, we'll see what happens there. But they need to figure something out, and I think it'll be interesting to see what happens. If it is Ordeo going down, which makes the most sense to me, I still think you'll be able to sneak him through waivers right now because of he's had so few games, and the ones he has had haven't looked good. Or if they sign somebody else.
We will see.
So, Matt, we're at the quarter point in the season now. 21 games have been played. The Flames' record now is 8 wins, 12 losses, 1 OT loss. We're sitting at 17 points. Chicago is the second wildcard team at 24. And if you look at our division right now, the Pacific Division is looking pretty weak this year. Arizona's got 21 points. Calgary's got 17. Colorado's got 15. And Edmonton's got 15. Really, we're within, you know, a half dozen points of the playoffs at this point as we sit here tonight and record this show. We're 7 points out of the playoffs. Do you think the Flames, if they can keep playing the way they have this week, can get themselves back into this season?
The main thing that the Flames need to do is just collect points in the standings. And whether that's losing games in overtime, winning games outright, as long as they continue to get points, they'll be fine. The games that truly matter, though, the most are the interdivisional games.
Yeah, and you can't give up points in those ones either.
No, you can't win games in overtime against, say, Anaheim, LA, San Jose. you have to beat them in regulation and handily, if possible.
Yeah, I mean, we don't get points for beating them 7-1, but as long as you're picking up two against them and they're not picking anything up, that's the important thing.
Exactly. And with the Vancouver and Arizona being two of the teams that are ahead of the Flames, I'm not really overly concerned with either team. They're not very good. Like, they're in a playoff spot, one of them, and the other's a point back, but overall, as a team, they don't really inspire a lot of fear, and I think if they were in the Central Division, they'd be right there with Colorado. But the Flames just need to find a way to get near where San Jose and LA are. Because you know that Anaheim's going to bounce back. They're not nearly as bad as they have been. Somewhat similar to how the Flames haven't been. They're not as bad of a team as they've shown in the first month. So, as long as they can get within like 2 or 3 points of the playoffs by January 1st, I think that'll set themselves up for the second half of the season rather well. Like, especially in January and February, a lot of the games that the Flames play are against teams that are on the weaker side of the ledger. So,
yeah,
there's a better chance to make up some ground then. It's just between now and then, a lot of the games are against the elite teams in the league, so it'll be fun.
And even if we can't win all those elite games, I think you have to see the Flames play like they have the last two games. We're starting to see this team coming back into the form from last year, and they have to keep that up. If they keep doing like they were at the beginning, where they'd play okay, then they'd run out of gas halfway through, you're not going to be able to get anywhere near the playoffs. And I think you have to, as a coaching staff, try to keep these guys in whatever rhythm they've got.
Oh, for sure. And
because, you know, we've won two in a row and we've lost so many, we have to start making up some ground here.
Exactly.
We can't wait till January to do that.
Oh, for sure. And, like, if you look at, like, our schedule, like, heading into next month, the only two easy games that the Flames play are against Edmonton and Buffalo. The rest of them are against either Central Division teams, Anaheim twice, San Jose, LA, Detroit, Boston, New York. Like, none of those games are going to be easy. So, in order for the Flames to actually make a dent in the hole that they've dug themselves, they have to find ways to beat all of these really good teams. It's not going to be easy, but if they can claw their way back where they're somewhat close to a playoff spot by January 1st, I think they will have enough momentum to push themselves all the way and make a real fight to come back. If they're 5, 6, 7 points out by January 1st or more, then might as well just pack it in.
Yeah, I don't know. When you look at the standings this year, it's so weird because, you know, you've got Calgary at 17 points, who's sixth in the West. But then you've got Vancouver is not that much up on us. And right now we're closer to the bottom than we are to the playoffs. But the race is so narrow that I can see, I mean, everybody in the West. You know, you've got San Jose sitting at number one in the Pacific with 26 points. You got Dallas sitting at number one in the West with 34. Like, it's, and Calgary's got 17. So if we run into a good streak, we can make up ground, but then everyone else is going to be making up ground too. So I think this is going to be a tight race for all teams this year.
Oh, for sure. And the one redeeming quality is that we're in the worst division in the NHL, and three of the teams in our division have to make the playoffs regardless. So with that, the Flames have a better opportunity to squeak into one of those spots. It's just the only way that they're going to be able to get there is simply putting points on the board.
Yeah. And soon.
Yeah, they have to basically just keep winning. Like, if they can, like, over a 10-game stretch, if they can get 13 points every 10 games, pretty much through the rest of the season, they should be able to build their way back. But if they're struggling or even going 500, there's just simply not enough games in the season left to overcome that kind of a deficit.
No, and I think the biggest issue you're going to find, too, if you look at it, that the Flames really are going to have to correct in order to make, even if they can make up some of that, is the goals for goals against differential. And just looking at the stats, we have to have the biggest difference there. We have 50 goals for at this point and 75 against. So the Flames are really going to have to tighten that up to, I mean, that's, you know, minus 25 goals in our favor. We're really going to have to start tightening that up if we want to get anywhere near the playoffs, because if we keep getting lit up 4-1, 5-1, even if we're winning quite a few of them, that's not the way that you end up making the playoffs.
No. And like, if you look at the last three wins for the Flames, each of them were by a single goal, which that's good that they won, but
yeah,
you need to have some more separation, sort of like the Penguins game where they won 5-2. Another good thing, though, with how the schedule has been, Calgary has only played four games against teams in our own division. The first two games of the season against Vancouver and a pair against the Oilers, and they're 2-2 in those games. So even though they've struggled, it's been against teams that don't necessarily really matter that much to the Flames situation. It's not like we've been coughing up points against the teams that are ahead of us.
And we've played quite a few Eastern Conference teams too, and if you look at our December schedule, quite a few more Eastern Conference teams.
Oh, for sure.
Which mean even less to the standings.
Yeah, but if the Flames can start winning a lot of the games that they play against their division, that will help them to leapfrog up the standings instead of toiling near the bottom.
Yeah, I mean, if we have to give up a point, as we have in, you know, so many games already, we have to be doing it in those Eastern Conference games when Boston's coming to town or Buffalo or New York. Those are the games where if we have to leave a point on the table, you do it there, but we can't afford to give... I mean, even if you look right now, the Ducks are 1 point ahead of us. We leave a point on the table tomorrow, they're still ahead of us.
Yeah, exactly. And that's not an ideal situation.
So we need to start winning in 60. We can't, you know, as much as we've shown we can get it done in the three-on-three, we can't be going there. We need to get it done with five guys in the ice.
Oh, for sure. And that's like the next step for the Flames, is to earn regulation wins, because I think they only have three regulation victories through the 21 games. So that's like the next marker for the Flames to, like, now they're winning games more regularly. Now they have to.
We've shown we can win. Now we got to do it in 60.
Exactly.
Matt, do you want to give us a bit of an update on the HL? We talked earlier about Kevin Poulin and what happened with him, but how's the Stockton Heat been doing this past week?
Pretty good. They won both their games. The first one was a 4-0 shutout victory, courtesy of Kevin Poulin, who wasn't really tested all that much. He only made 19 saves in the win. Derek Grant, who was assigned to Stockton this past week, scored twice, including an empty netter. It was a solid game. They were the better team, but there's still some hiccups in their game. They're not fully clicking on full cylinders. And then the second game, they beat the San Jose Barracuda 4-3 in a shootout. They got out to a 2-0 lead in the first period. San Jose, their defense was extremely terrible in the first period. I think Calgary had like 9 or 10 2-on-1s or 3-on-1s. That many 2-on-1s, and just eventually some of those have to go in. And then in the second and third periods, they let their foot off the gas, and some of the defensemen made some careless mistakes that led to goals. Most notably, Patrick Seeloff let a very bad turnover that pretty much went directly into the net seconds later, and that was the go-ahead goal. Emile Poirier got off his little slump scoring his first goal of the season to tie the game in that one, and then they eventually went on to win in the shootout where they scored four times out of the five shots they took. And Poulin, of course, went down with an injury in that. Overall, I think that the most improved player thus far, as the season's gone on, has been Oliver Shillington. He has really started to play well defensively, which is actually a pleasant surprise. There was one play in particular where San Jose went in on a 2-on-1, and he was at the red line, and the other guy was about 10 feet in front of him, and he actually managed to get back and cover the guy and stole the puck off him to negate the play. And he's still making a couple of mistakes, but they're getting fewer and further between. And just a lot more steady play, making the easy passes instead of trying to be the superstar. So that's a very encouraging thing to see.
Yeah, and we see that a lot with guys who come over to a system like the Flames, where they're used to being the superstar. They're used to being the guy. We see it a lot more with forwards than defensemen, but now they're being asked to be a guy, and they have to really, I think, work through that mindset of, it's not just me anymore. I don't need to carry this team on my shoulders, and sometimes I can't do what I'm used to doing.
Mm-hmm.
And I think once he gets more comfortable with that, from what I've seen, he looks like he's ready to play Shillington does at the pro level. It's not a case of, wow, this guy's a bust or anything. He just needs to adjust to playing, you know, at the AHL tempo and finding his role within the team.
Yeah, and having two coaches on the team that are really good with working with defensemen and Ryan Huska and Todd Gill, especially Gill, considering he played over 1,000 games in the NHL as a defensive defenseman, I think that their instructions will help him more so than anything. And he has improved significantly, because that was his major weakness, was that he was basically a fish out of water defensively, and now he's looking more like a solid, composed defenseman.
You also mentioned Emile Poirier. Poirier's not looking all that great this year. He's played 12 games, he has one goal and four assists. What do you think's going on with Poirier? Sophomore slump?
The first handful of games, he was really not playing at all like how he normally does. He wasn't going to the spots he normally does. It was almost like he was being told to focus on defensive positioning more so than anything. Because a lot of the plays that he would make, they were kind of confusing for how he normally played. But recently, he's been looking more like himself the last, like, four or five games. Last week, there was one play where he was set up for a one-timer, and it was pretty much in the perfect position. The goalie was out of the way. It would have been a tap-in goal, and the puck copped on him. So, like, he was starting to do all the right things. The puck just wasn't being cooperative. And even in the game that he did score, it looked like he was going to score. It was a matter of time. He just kept throwing the pucks on the net. It just wasn't going in until it eventually did. And he was extremely pleased when he actually put it in. A nice little celebration, jumping into the glass and everything. So it was nice to see. And hopefully now that the monkey's off his shoulder, he can get back at it and start popping goals in with some more regularity.
Yeah, I'm hoping after this they'll just flow from here. I mean, he's been slumping, and he's one of the guys we need a good season from to have that he'd be successful this year. So hopefully this is going to put him back on the right track.
Yeah, and Stockton played rather well in that second game. They fired 53 shots on San Jose, which is fairly impressive. And the only reason why they didn't win the game, like, 8-3, it was Grosnick for San Jose. He was standing on his head pretty much all night. Until the shootout, in which he let in four of the five shots, because why not?
Well, it's good to hear that team's turning around. I know they were having some struggles early on, too, and it sounds like things are definitely picking up down there.
Yeah, it seems like both the Flames teams are at each level have had the exact same season thus far. Like, they just couldn't figure anything out correctly in the first month, and now are starting to hit their stride.
Yeah, it's kind of funny that way. You're right. It almost seems like when one team struggles, they both struggle. When one team does well, they both do well. So that's kind of weird. Matt, why don't we end off this week by talking a little bit about some things going on around the NHL, not necessarily specifically Flames news. Unless there's anything else Flames related you want to talk directly about?
Nah, I'm good.
The big news, I guess, on the rumor front, we haven't seen a big trade yet this year, not from the Flames, but from any team. And the news came out this past week that New York Islanders defenseman Travis Harmonic has asked to be traded to a team in Western Canada. I'd say probably there's a few American teams that might be in there as well, but he's asked to be moved to Western Canada for an unspecified family reason. And, of course, this has made a lot of people speculate about if the Flames might be in on this deal and if he'd be good here. Apparently, the asking price from what Garth Snow has asked is either TJ Brody or Dougie Hamilton. At that price, do you want to see the Flames bring Hamonic in?
Why would you? Even if Hamonic is as good as either of those players, you're just shuffling deck chairs, which that doesn't make any sense.
I think Hamonic here would be a solid four, and I think you don't trade your arguably two and three piece to bring in a four piece.
Or even arguably your number one and number two piece.
Yeah,
for
true.
The future, anyway.
For the future, sure, yeah.
Yeah, unless you're getting, like, the only way I would trade Hamilton or Brody for Hamonic is if Okposo was coming and another significant piece, and no. So
yeah, one for one, it's a foolish deal. It'd have to be a big, and I think if you look at any of the teams that are on a Calgary, Edmonton, Winnipeg, to get this done, I think it's going to have to be a significant package moving both ways.
Yeah, and I don't see any reason why the Flames should do this. Yes, you'd like a guy like Hamonic. I think 30 teams in the NHL would like a guy like Travis Hamonic, but the ever-present how much is the question, and it doesn't make sense to trade a high-level asset for another high-level asset when there's not really any difference between them. And like it would be one thing like if we were trading, say, like a forward for a defenseman or a goalie for a defenseman, if that's what we were wanting to do, but trading one defender for another, there doesn't really seem to be a need. Like, it's not like Hamilton or Brody are struggling where they need a change of scenery. So, yeah, it doesn't really make a lot of sense to me.
And I think one of the things that could help or hurt the Islanders in the trade, depending on how you look at it, is Hamonic has a great contract. If Hamonic had a terrible contract, I mean, he's making 3.8 this year, I believe. And his salary hit is 3.7 this year, and then he's on a 4.875 deal after that. For a number four guy, that's very affordable. And I think there's a lot of teams that want him simply because it's affordable. And I think that's going to let the Islanders get more value if they can find a buyer for Hamonic than maybe he's worth, because they're going, wow, you know, like if you look at what Brody's making and even what Russell's making, Hamonic would be a great value for us, but I think that the asking price is too rich. I mean,
yeah,
you know, if you look at Russell making 2.6, you look at Brody making 4.8, Brody's making about the same as Hamonic. I think if I was going to make that trade, you really need to try and move either Weidman or Russell as a blue line piece. And if we could do Russell and or Weidman as the key piece with a couple other throw-ins, it'd be worth looking at, but I'm not willing to move any of the top three right now.
Yeah. Like, say, like, if the trade was, say, Russell or Weidman plus, say, Backlund plus, say, Poirier or Granlund, and maybe a pick or something for Hamonic, I think that would be doable. But trading one top defenseman for another, it just doesn't financially make any sense.
No.
And especially like in the free agent market, like if the Flames want to just say, you know, move Russell out and Weidman out and all that, you can just spend some money on a free agent that's going to be more or less the same. It, not necessarily the age department, but for the end results at the end of the season, and you don't have to give up, you know, a Brody or a Hamilton. So I don't see a fit for the Flames, really, unless the Islanders are more content taking forward depth than defending depth.
Now, I don't know if they would do this, but if you look right now, the Islanders are tied with New Jersey for the wild card spot in the East. Tampa Bay's right on their doorstep. If the Islanders start deciding that they need to make a playoff run this year, maybe, and it would be a stretch, but maybe you could end up giving them, say, Russell and Hudler and a pick or a big piece to bring in Hamonic if they just need to move him out of there.
I could see that.
That I would look at. We've got pieces we need to move. Those guys are UFAs. Why not rent them to the Islanders and solve one of their problems at the same time?
And that could very well be a scenario that works. It just depends on who, what, where, when, why. And honestly, I think if any team's going to make a deal with the Islanders, I think it'll be the Winnipeg Jets, just due to the fact that they have the type of defenseman that the Islanders, and the quantity of defenseman that the Islanders are looking for, where the Flames, they don't really have any depth beyond the top five guys. Not anybody that can step in tomorrow and play one of those positions. Anyway.
Yeah, no, I agree with you. And I think what we're seeing right now is, I think we're seeing Garth Snow do what we usually see from a GM in his place, I guess, and he's trying to see exactly what he can get. And of course, you're going to ask high.
Oh, of course.
You know, if the Flames will give you Brody, you're going to ask for Brody.
Oh, yeah.
So we're seeing the initial offers. I mean, this just came out this week, and I think that as time goes on, we're going to start to find out that, hey, this offer goes down. And I don't know how urgently Hamonic needs this move, like if this is something they have to get done, or if it's just a nice to do this season, but I think you may end up seeing that they need to move this guy, and Calgary has some pieces they're going to move anyways, and I can see us just moving rental pieces, maybe a draft pick or one, you know, younger player to bring Hamonic in if this drags on into January.
Oh, for sure. And it would largely depend on the asking price coming down or being modified to involve forwards instead. Because the Islanders, they don't really have a lot of depth in their organization, and especially if they lose Okposo in the offseason, they are going to need some more forward skill coming in. So the Flames, one of their hallmarks is having a ton of offensive depth through the organization. So there could be a way to do it that way, but we'll have to wait and see.
I think if you look at the Western Canadian teams in general, if we take Vancouver out of it, because it's been said that Calgary, Edmonton, and Winnipeg are the suitors, there's not a lot of defensive depth to go around there in general. I mean, Edmonton doesn't really have anything you want.
No.
Winnipeg's got some, but I don't think would part with it for Hamonic.
No, in the Jets' case, like, I could see them, say, trading Tobias Enstrom plus, say, Kyle Connor, their first-round pick from last year, in a trade for Hamonic. That would be pretty much,
I think that's the best defensive piece you're going to get out of the Western Canada is Enstrom.
Yeah, because like, I don't see the Oilers trading Darnell Nurse because he's really their only defenseman.
Yeah.
And like, Klefbom's not good enough to be worth a Hamonic. So like, I could see the,
if you're going to make a Western Canadian trade, it's going to have to be to take forwards,
yeah,
or goalies.
Like, I could see the Oilers trading a guy like Jordan Eberle for Hamonic. That would make some sense. But, yeah, there's not really a fit with any of those teams with defensemen. Like, even the Minnesota Wild, who of course, is an American team, but close to the border, they don't have anybody that's sheddable from their defensive core. Like, if it was a team like Nashville, where you have a whole bunch of guys, then that would work, but Nashville's not exactly close to Canada.
No, and we don't know the whole scenario. We don't know what's going on, but anytime a guy makes it known that I need to be moved, historically, you don't get much for that player.
No.
And
not at all. And usually, like, in situations where either a team is desperate to move the player and doesn't really announce that they're available, sort of like the Dion Phaneuf trade or even acquiring Hamilton, or situations where a guy demands a trade to, like, one of three teams, the return's rarely even close to being fair.
And that's why I think, depending on how long this drags on, you might see Garth Snow just need to liquidate the asset and say, yeah, we'll take Hudler and we'll take Russell.
Yeah, and that could very well happen.
And I think that would be a fair return based on, I mean, we'd be getting a better deal, but I think it's a fair return based on the rock and the hard place that Snow's put between.
Exactly. And, like, yeah, he might be asking for Brody and Hamilton, but no sane team's going to trade that, so.
No, I mean, I think we're comfortable with our top-end defense now that we have Hamilton. If we didn't get Hamilton this summer, maybe the Flames would look more aggressively at trading for Hamonic to round out that top three. But you're not going to put together a package of bottom six guys in our rotation for Hamonic. I mean, they're not going to take a Smeed in England.
No. That'd be nice, but that kind of stuff only happens in, like, NHL 16 if you have the trade thing.
I don't even know if NHL 16 is stupid enough for that.
Yeah, only if you have, like, the trade blocker off type of thing.
Yeah, you know.
You must accept any offer.
So, and I don't know. I honestly don't know the details of the Hamonic thing. I don't know how bad it's going to get, if he's going to refuse to play for the team, you know, after this year, if he's not near his family. He's refusing to comment on it. And we don't know who leaked the story, if it was his agent or if it was the team. I'm guessing it's probably his agent.
Yeah, I don't see the team shooting themselves in the foot. Because, like, say Sven Berchi last year, he demanded a trade, and it didn't come out that he did until...
Well, after we moved him.
Yeah, and Treliving, when he came to the press conference thing, said, yeah, he said he wasn't going to sign with us, so we were pretty much forced to take any deal.
Yeah, and we still got, I think we got a very good deal for Sven.
Oh yeah, for sure. And especially that type of player in that type of situation. Like, we got Joe Colborn for a fourth round pick, and very similar situation where, you know, there wasn't, you know what I mean?
Yeah, and I think that's probably why the Hamonic camp would have gone to the media and said, hey, we want him to move, because they're just saying, okay, Garth can't get a good deal for him, so we're letting everyone know he wants to move just so Garth will take anything and move him.
Exactly. I don't see this situation resolving itself until probably January, February, if at all this season, but it depends on how urgent it's needed to happen.
Yeah. Yeah, I think the Islanders are going to end up making this a business trade as opposed to a hockey trade.
Mm-hmm.
And I think right now they're trying to make it a hockey trade. If you look at the different guys they're trying to get from the various teams, and I think it's going to come down to, what have you got? Okay, good enough.
Yeah. And realistically, in terms of just raw assets, I think the two favorites to land him are us and Winnipeg, just because those two teams have drafted very well in the past, like, 5 years, so we just not...
Yeah, though at the same time, I can see Chiarelli, after losing out on Hamilton, wanting to get this deal done.
Yeah. Do you see Griffin Reinhart going back to the island?
I personally don't know, and I think if Edmonton were to do the deal, Edmonton would have to say, this guy's now our cornerstone on the blue line, and pay for him accordingly.
Yeah.
You'd have to give up either a first round or a second round pick or Jordan Eberle or some piece where you say, you know, this is now our cornerstone on that blue line to build around. And I wouldn't want to build around Hamonic. I like the guy, but I don't think he's a 1-2.
No, neither do I.
But but he might be in Edmonton.
Yeah, and well,
at least for now, until you bring in a new 1-2 and he slides to a 3-4.
Exactly. And realistically, the Flames, like, if they were to acquire him, he would be the number 4 guy behind all of Giordano, Brody, and Hamilton. So it's not really as urgently needed. Like, it would be a nice thing to have, and you always go shopping for guys like that. But does it make sense? And if it doesn't, and another team, say like Edmonton, who has a bigger need for the player, wants to pay more, fine.
And I think the most interesting thing about the Hamonic deal to me is we've talked about what Russell might want, and we've talked about how Russell's making 2.6 this year and would probably look for about 4 next year. And Hamonic's making 4.8 next year. I think Hamonic is more worth $4 million. If we're saying we're going to allot $4 million, let's say, to a fourth defenseman, I'd take Hamonic at 4 over Russell at 4 any day.
Oh, for sure. And that's why, like, if the acquisition does not make any sense, I have no problem waiting till the offseason and seeing what's available on the free agent market, just due to the fact that you could get a guy that's of a caliber that he can slot in as the number 4 for $4 million and fill that role if you're not going to retain Russell. So, we'll see. It's one of those things that it'll just depend on between now and July 1st what's available and go from there. If another defender like Hamilton falls in your lap, you make the trade. If not, then you survey the field and see what else is available.
And I think you said it right earlier. We don't need a number 4 guy. We don't need to go out and make this deal. We don't need to be the hungriest team, you know, trying to get Hamonic. And if another team makes a better offer, I think that we have to, and I think Trelevy knows as well, you have to be willing to just walk away on this one.
Yeah, exactly. Like, if somebody wants, say, like Edmonton offers Eberle, the Flames aren't going to give up something of that caliber. There's no need to. You know, there are 30 teams, and just because Edmonton would acquire Hamonic does not necessarily mean that they're going to magically become a good team. So, you know, it would suck to see a guy like that go to a team that's your rival, but at the end of the day, if it doesn't make sense for you, you just don't pull the trigger.
You know, like, I know the Flames were really in on the Hamilton deal, and they kept, you know, working that deal and changing that deal and getting something that works. And I think on Hamonic, I would kick the tires.
Oh, yeah. You
put out my offer and then walk away. I wouldn't keep going back and forth and saying, well, how about this? How about this? It's here's my deal. Call me if you want to take this. Or a slight variation thereof. But I wouldn't be continually going back saying, oh, Edmonton's doing Eberle. Okay, we'll do this. Oh, you know, Winnipeg's doing this. We'll keep adjusting this deal.
Yeah, I would to an extent, but knowing, like, what your maximum comfort level is, like, if the asset value is over this threshold, you walk away, and, like, you just try to find some permutation under that threshold that works for you.
Yeah, that's a good way to look at it.
Because, like, it just depends, like everything.
We'll see how it goes, but I would be surprised to see Hamonic here soon. I would be surprised to see him here before Christmas. I would not be surprised to see him here by the end of the year, but I also wouldn't be surprised to see him here. I know that sounds weird, but I think if he comes here, it'll be a deal that gets done later in the year, but I don't think the Flames are just out gunning to get this thing done.
No. If it works, it works. If not, it doesn't. That's about it.
We got our big defensive score this summer with Hamilton, and I think, you know, you can look at that and say, okay, we got our guy.
Yeah, now it's just a matter of figuring out and sorting out the 4, 5, 6 guys, not only for the balance of this season, but for next year and beyond.
Yeah, and that's where I think we're going to see big changes. I think we now have the top 3 locked in, and I think you're going to see probably a 4 brought in off as a free agent or through trade, and then the 5, 6 guys probably, you know, called up through the system.
Yeah, I can see that.
The other interesting piece of NHL news this week is that the NHL is borrowing a page from the NFL's playbook. Not something that we see often, two very different sports, but the NHL has announced, along with the NHLPA, that starting next season, every team in the NHL will get a bye week, a five-day bye week, very similar to what the NFL does. So according to Pierre LeBrun on ESPN's website, the way this is going to work is the league and the NHL have committed to building a bye week into each team's schedule for 1 week between January 1st and February 28th. So sometime in January or February, every team gets 1 week off. Players won't have to report for practice until after 4 p.m. on the fifth day if they have a game on the sixth day. However, if the players don't have a game on the sixth day, they'd have the entire fifth day off. For the NHLPA, this is probably important if you think about it for a couple reasons. So many guys like Olympic years because it gives them time to heal. It gives them time to sit off and relax. And, you know, if you look at the 700-plus players in the NHL, there's probably, 70 that go to the Olympics? So a lot of them are just sitting around and relaxing. And same reason a lot of guys like the All-Star break. And the reason we've even seen some of the big-name guys not go to the All-Star break is to heal and rest. So it's going to be interesting. You know, can you imagine how that's going to change the scheduling for next year?
Well, I think the main difference, like, especially in the early part of the season, is you won't see teams like playing once or twice and then having like 4 or 5 days off right off the bat.
You're going to have to compress more of those games. Very similar to an Olympic year.
Yeah, and that's fine. Like, I think a lot of teams would rather have, especially like right in the first month and a half, 2 months of the season, have situations where you're playing every second or third day right through and until Christmas, really.
Yeah, and if you look at the Flames schedule this year, and, you know, I mean, even this month we're seeing it, they're playing two games, three games a week. You know, this week they play three games. Next week, the first week in December, they play two games. Late in December on the, 25th? No, 19th and 22nd, they play two games. So a lot of time that could be compressed if we wanted to.
Yeah, and it wouldn't necessarily need to be that drastic a change. It's just not as sporadic as it has been.
I can see all of the arena bookers now trying to figure out when their team's off so they can go book a week worth of concerts.
Exactly. There's always ways of working around things, so I'm sure that it'll work itself out.
In theory, do you think it's a good idea or a bad idea?
Good idea. Because I think that typically you get a rash of injuries regardless of how often you're playing. So just having a handful of days off at some point, it will help both just for the players to get off of hockey for a bit and allow teams to rest up and recuperate.
And I like where they're putting it, too. It's not the NFL where your bye can really come at any time. And you look at some of these teams that get a bye in week three, and it's like, well, we don't really need the rest yet. So I like that the NHL is putting it sometime between January 1st and February 28th. That's sort of your midpoint in the season. I think that's a good time to sort of rest and recover. My worry would be a team starting to gain momentum. Like, if you think about this year, that might be when Calgary's starting to get their momentum. And does a week not at the rink, not even practicing, just not on the ice at all officially, does that kill momentum?
Possibly, but yeah, I think every team's going to be going through the same thing, so it's not like we're the only team that has that problem. So
that's true.
And especially I like it because of the fact that it's not too early in the season and it's not too late in the season.
Yeah, well, that's kind of what I mean about the NFL. Like, if they just said, oh, we'll give you a bye week, but it could be any time, your bye week could be the second week of the season.
Yeah, or the first week even. And it's like, oh, great, awesome. You know,
yeah,
we just finished training camp, and now we get to sit on our ass for a week. It's like, you know, that wouldn't make a lot of sense.
The only way that could become advantageous to certain teams is to rest up for a week before the playoffs, if you had the last bye week.
True, but even then, I think that would do more harm than good anyway, so.
And if you looked at that's really, I mean, January, you know, in February, that's really 8 weeks, and we have 30 teams. I think you're going to, I mean, you're going to have some teams playing every week, but I think you're going to see a lot less games played. If you've got to sit 30 teams for at least a week every 8 weeks, I think you'll probably see, you know, a very sporadic number of games played those months. Your schedules are going to be very sparse.
Not necessarily. Like, if you...
Not per team, but as I guess more as a TV network. Instead of having 6-7 games a night, you might have 2.
No, not necessarily, because realistically, you're only going to have 3 teams a week that aren't playing. So if you make up those games over the 7 weeks, I don't see it being a problem.
It's true, yeah. If you're playing 3 games a week, I guess, and really, I mean, the average team's playing 3-4 games a week, so that only means you... It's not even going to mean as compressed a schedule as we'd see in an Olympic year. It just means moving 4 games.
Yeah, so not a big deal.
It's not a huge deal. I'll be curious to see as the rules come out around this, if there's any rules, like if a trade freeze is put in, for example, during your bye week.
Yeah.
And we know the NHL puts in a Christmas trade freeze. I could see them going either way. I could see them saying, okay, it's a rest week. You can't make a trade because those guys are resting. But I could all see it just being business as usual. So as we get more details around this, we'll be curious to see exactly where we go with it. But I think it's a good idea. I think it's good that the NHL's trying new things. I mean, you know, this never probably would have flown a couple years ago. And we're seeing this. We're seeing the 3-on-3 overtime. It seems like the NHL's taking more chances, more, I don't want to say more risks, but taking more unconventional looks at things that maybe they wouldn't have a couple years ago.
Yeah, and they're getting a lot of thoughts from former players. Like, I know, like, the change to the face-off rules where if you're in the defensive zone, you're going in first in the face-offs. Like, that was a consultation with Ron Francis and a couple other centers that said that that does make a little bit of a difference. So, you know, willingness to listen to players and try to make the game better, that's always a good thing. Sometimes it doesn't work out, sometimes it does. Like the 3-on-3 overtime, I think, has been a success thus far for most teams. Not necessarily in terms of results, but just for the action on the ice. And
I don't think it's a perfect system, but I think it's the right move towards a perfect system.
Yeah. Like, honestly, for me, I would have preferred them doing 5 minutes 4-on-4, then 5 minutes 3-on-3.
What the AHL did last year.
Yeah, but it's better than what it was. So anything that reduces the amount of shootouts is all good in my book.
And I think we can still get there.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. We'll see. Like everything, well, Matt, it depends on fan feedback and all that. So,
and the American fans and what they want to see. Well, Matt, before we wrap up this week, I want to let everybody know we are very pleased that in two weeks here on Fireside, actually next week here on Fireside Chat, we're going to have a special guest joining us for a pre-recorded interview. Former Flame Theo Fleury is going to be stopping by. He's going to do a pre-recorded interview with us on December 2nd, and that'll be inserted into a show later in December. Theo's going to be coming by to chat about his new album. He's got a country music album out called I Am Who I Am. He has a tour for him and his band coming this year, and we'll catch up with him and see what he's been up to since he left the Flames. So that's the latest interview in our old Flame series. You might remember a few seasons ago we interviewed Cale Hulse, Rico Fatta, and former captain Todd Simpson. And as usual, we want all of our listeners to get involved with this. So if you go to the Fireside Chat website at firesidechat.ca, you'll see on the homepage under latest articles, an article that says Theo Fleury's coming to Fireside Chat. And on that page, we have a form. So if you want to ask Theo a question, submit the question to us. If we can get it on the air, we will. If we can ask Theo the question, we will. And I'm really looking forward to chatting with Theo. As a kid growing up, Theo was always the face of the Flames to me. So it's going to be really cool to chat with him and see what he's up to.
Yeah, I am glad that we're able to have him on, and I'm looking extremely forward to that interview.
Yeah, me too. And if anyone's looking for something new to listen to this week, check out the website. We have a link to where you can buy his album, I Am Who I Am. It's available through any music retailer, but we have a link to Amazon where you can pick up the CD for $10. So if you're a Fleury fan or you've got someone in your life who's a Fleury fan, could be a good stocking stuffer. But grab a copy of I Am Who I Am. And, I mean, if you remember, Fleury's played hockey. He's played baseball. He played a couple of games of pro baseball here in Calgary. Now he's a country artist. This guy's had quite the career.
Yeah, he likes getting into whatever he's interested in, and that's a good thing.
Yeah, so we'll chat with him next week, but hopefully you guys will submit some questions to help us out there. Well, Matt, as always, it's time for our predictions for the coming week. If we look back at last week we had 4 points on the table, 2 games, and I was the party pooper here. I thought that the Flames were going to get a big goose egg and get 0 points, lose to both New Jersey and to Chicago. You thought the Flames would beat New Jersey and lose Chicago, and it turned out we were both wrong, which is what we were actually hoping for.
Yeah.
Flames walked away from the four-point week with 4 points, which means neither of us gets a point this week.
Yeah, I think one of us should bite the bullet and go for opposite predictions from now on.
Just the total opposite of what we want.
Yeah, because the week prior, I picked every game wrong. Last week, you picked every game wrong, so... Yeah.
Well, the week that I picked zero, we got them all. So maybe someone's got to just keep picking zero. Somebody's got to be our pessimistic Flames fan. Well, this week we got 6 points on the table, 3 games. Tuesday night, the Flames travel to the Honda Center to take on the Ducks. That's an 8 p.m. start here in Calgary. Then we have a couple days off. The Flames on Friday will take on the Arizona Coyotes. And then Saturday, they move on to the San Jose Sharks in the second of the back-to-back. So let's ask the first question, Matt. Can we break the Honda Center curse?
In some ways, I'd like them not to. They are only one loss away from the NHL record of 23 consecutive losses by the Pittsburgh Penguins against the Philadelphia Flyers.
Is that really a record we want to hold, though?
Well, I think that if you're going to suck that long against one team in one city, you might as well make a record of it. You know what I mean? They've been historically bad against Anaheim in Anaheim. They only have 8 wins in their entire franchise history against the Ducks in Anaheim. For comparison, the Flames have 29 victories in Calgary. It's actually kind of amusing. The Flames have a .625 winning percentage in Calgary against Anaheim, and yet they only won 25% of the games in Anaheim. It's kind of bizarre.
That is crazy. So you don't want them to beat the Honda Center curse?
Well, I do, but...
But not this time.
Yeah, if they lose, it's one of those things where... It would be an amusing anecdote of how futile the Flames have been in Anaheim.
Well, we can lose there this time then, and then beat the curse on February 21st when we play there again.
Sounds like a plan.
So you're gonna say no to the win in Anaheim. What about the back to back? We play Arizona and San Jose. How do you see that one shaking down?
I think that they'll drop the Coyotes game and beat San Jose.
So you're going for 2 points this week just against San Jose?
Yes. I'm going to be the pessimistic one.
All right. Well, I was not going to go for two, nor was I going to go for zero. So you're the pessimist this week. You could have said zero, but my heart tells me they're not going to win in Anaheim. As much as I want them to, just because it feels like if we're going to get energized this year and we need to get this team going, nothing would be a better piece to this year's story than to break that curse.
Yeah. Oh, for sure.
We've got 2 wins. We're rolling into Anaheim. We're trying to get things picked up. We beat the curse. We break that curse, and we roll right through there. That's the story the Flames need.
Yeah.
But I don't think that's the story the Flames get.
No. And especially with Anaheim playing better of late. If it was in the first month, we might have been able to. But, yeah, I don't see it.
I can't see it happening. If you look at our record in back-to-backs this year, we've not done well. We've generally either lost them both or won them both. And when we do win, it's the second of the back-to-backs. So your prediction makes the most sense historically this season. I'm going to match you in 2 points, but I think we're going to beat Phoenix.
Okay.
I think Phoenix... I can't... I can't logically give us the Anaheim game.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't think we can go back-to-back against Anaheim or against Arizona and San Jose. As much as I'd love for us to win both of those, that's a tough back-to-back to win, especially with goaltending uncertainties right now. I think Phoenix underestimates Calgary, and we're able to beat them. But we'll see. We'll see how that turns out. I hope at least one of us is right. We at least get 2 points this week. Because if we get skunked, we're right back to where we started.
Well, honestly, if we only get 2 points out of this week, we're pretty much screwed anyway. Because these are all interdivisional games.
That's true.
All four-point games, if you like. So we need 4 or 6 if we're going to have any momentum moving into December. So if we only get 2, we're screwed.
The story I want to tell is we win in Anaheim, we roll through Phoenix, or I guess Arizona, and maybe we struggle with the Sharks. Yeah. That's the story I want them to tell this week.
No.
I don't think it's a story we get.
Yeah.
If we can't win a game this year, we're right back to where we started. We drop 3 important games, and the Flames are on the outside looking in once again. So I think if we look at the schedule so far this year, like you said, it's 3 divisional games. I think of all the weeks so far, this is the make-or-break week for us.
Yeah. If the Flames can find a way to win all 3 games, then I think they're right back in the playoff picture and can carry on like the whole first month didn't really happen.
Yeah, and not only just from a stats perspective, but I think the momentum you'd get from that would be unimaginable. And then we have
Because like especially if you came into a 5-game homestand starting December off on a 5-game winning streak, winning 6 of 7,
and considering we've won the last 4 at home,
yeah,
every game we played in November at home we've won.
So that would definitely help. It's just they have to add, to steal the line from last week, they have to put up or shut up, and this is the biggest week thus far this season.
We shall see how it goes.
Oh.
Well, Matt, let's enjoy the Flames hockey. Let's enjoy this road trip. You get a bit of a break from going to the Dome because you're going to be quite busy there in the beginning of December.
Yeah, for sure.
Actually, the whole month of December, you're going to be busy there.
Yeah, 9 games in 31 days. Woohoo.
Good Christmas gift to yourself.
Yeah.
And we will talk next week, and we hope that we're going to be moving out of here with better predictions than you and I made. We better not be worse.
Yeah.
But this team better at least...
They need at least 4.
Yeah. I mean, with the way they've played, I agree we need 4 to stay in it. I'd be happy with 2 just because it means we didn't lose the whole week.
Yeah.
But we need 4. If we can get 6, you and I are going to have a great show next week.
Yeah.
We're going to be in the best mood we can when it comes time to chatting with Theo.
Yeah, exactly. We'll see.
We'll see.
It's up to how the Flames play. It's all in the locker room. If they have the gumption to win, they will. So we'll see.
Mm-hmm. And, you know,
take care. Thanks for listening.
Yeah, have a good week, Matt. And we will talk to you next. I guess by the time everyone hears us next, it'll probably be December.
Yep.
Have a good one.
Take care, everybody.
Fireside Chat is hosted by Dan Stevenson, co-hosted by Matt DeBorg. This episode produced and edited by Peter Marino. Fireside Chat is licensed under a Creative Commons license. For full license details, visit firesidechat.ca.